And two tribes is us. The Nilotic tribes is the Africans, the Hamites, the Hamitic nations.
First person on earth was
Adam. No. Let's see. Let's go to Genesis real quick. Let's go. Genesis 1, 27. I know he deflected. Oh, yeah.
Yeah, science too. I put science with
you. Oh, nah, bro. You ain't ready for God science.
No.
Look. Hold on. Before we get there. Even knowing all that stuff, right? Who are you? What type? Because Indian means savage. So if you're a savage, which savage are you?
Aboriginal,
the word was termed to you by the so-called white man. So again, I'm going to ask you again, who are you? What stock or family or group of people or nation of people do you stem from? If it's African, which nation of Africa? There's 52 countries in Africa. You see that? You see how we can't go that deep? You see that? So knowing all about an E-gene and the woman this and that, that means a hill of beans if you don't know who you are. Because if you don't know who you are, I can abuse you, bro, through misinformation.
Because you're right. Because, you know, before the Pangea, the whole world was together. You know what I'm saying? Before everything broke up into its own country, the whole world was together. So who's to say that one was together? Say she women are together.
No. Because you're mixing a lot of histories. Let's get some sense first. Give me what I had you get first. Read that.
Genesis chapter 2 and verse 7. And the Lord God formed man of the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life.
So if God formed man of the dust of the ground, and remember, God said, I'm going to make man out of my own image, correct? If he formed man of the dust of the ground, why did God use dirt to represent his image in that man? Yes. God could have made us out of air. He could have made us out of water. He could have made us out of any element on the planet Earth. Why did he choose dirt to represent man on this Earth? Because I'm going somewhere with this. No. For God to use dirt, that's showing his skin color. He used the dirt of the planet to form the man that he put life into. And that life is going back to his commandments. Now, with Adam having an identity of the image of God, again, I'm going to ask you, what nation do you stem from to have that same image?
Shalom Israel, this is Bishop Nathaniel. I want you to know that you can view all our Sabbath classes live on IUIC TV. That's right, I said on IUIC TV. Download the app today. Shalom.
Okay, now help me out, okay? We take your legs going real fast.
Nation of Islam? Islam?
Israel, like, you know, the Jews.
Like, but most of the people think that the Jews are white.
Just like
I'm native.
We only pray to play, don't do
that. No, we do. But what I'm saying, look, you can't identify yourself, right? Give me Judith chapter 5, verse 20. You can't identify yourself with not being able to identify yourself. The enemy already won over you. I'm going to show you. Read that. Judith chapter 5, verse 20. I'm going to show you it's a ploy against you to keep you at Magic City Classic, keep you in sin, and keep you away from your identity. Because God gave the first man identity. But what is yours? Read.
Judith chapter 5, verse 20. Now therefore, my Lord and Governor, if there be any error in this people, and they sin against their God.
So the people is talking about the children of Israel. If there is any sin within our nation, read.
Let us consider that this shall be their ruin.
This is going to be their destruction. Read.
And let us go up, and we shall overcome them.
So now the nations know how to keep us down. They put us in sin and set up a system that's built off breaking God's law. with them doing that, they're able to exploit us because due to the contract that our forefathers signed with the Heavenly Father in blood, we cannot get those promises again until we repent. So now the other nations even know this. But keep reading.
But if there be no iniquity in their nation, let my Lord now pass by, lest their Lord defend them.
So now it says, if it's no sin, no transgression of God's law within their nation, do not mess with these people, because their God is going to fight for them and leave us as a reproach or a mocking for everybody to see, right? So let me pull something out. Give me that, finish it out.
And their God be for them, and we becoming a reproach before all the world.
So now they understand, if we're not in the midst of sin or breaking God's laws, they can't mess with us. But if we are, they can exploit us. They can do anything they want against us, right? So what is the number one sin that we're dealing with even today? Murder? What else? What about our dress code too? Yeah. Is it godly? Who wore robes? Yes, sir. Like this? Okay, let's see. Read 1 Timothy real quick. 1 Timothy 2 and 9. Let's see the dress code of God. Read.
1 Timothy chapter 2, verse 9. In like manner also, that women adorn themselves in modest apparel, with shamefacedness.
What does modest mean? What about you, sis? What does modest mean? That if you dress in modestly, that means that you're covering up not to draw sexual attention. Do our sisters at Magic City Classic dress up for sexual attention or for not to draw sexual attention? What?
Definitely for.
For sexual attention. Huh? They saying it, look. 75% of communication is nonverbal. The way you dress, the way you carry yourself shows what you're about. So if I can tell a hoe from a mile away just by how she dressed. I can tell a whoremonger from a mile away just how he acts. Is that true or am I lying? Okay, so now let's get furthermore on God's dress code. But look, I'm only here for a time. If you were to leave, let's say you wanted to come back. That's why I'm trying to show you who you are first before you leave. So now you know you have identity, and at least you know your heritage to keep God's law. Give me just 2 minutes to explain that to you. All right, read that.
Deuteronomy chapter 22, verse 5. The woman shall not wear that which pertaineth unto a man, neither shall a man put on a woman's garment.
What's a woman's garment that a man shouldn't wear? Panty shirts. What else? What else? Wigs. Makeup. All right. What about, what is something that... femininity? Okay. So what about the opposite? What is something that a woman shouldn't wear that a man has? If a man crosses over in the feminine state of a woman wearing her clothing, then what happens when a woman does it? I just said, most of your communication is nonverbal. So again, sis, what article of clothing belongs to a man that our sisters are wearing today? Hold on, read it again.
The woman shall not wear that which pertaineth.
It says wear not. So wear means article of clothing, physical. Read.
The woman shall not wear that which pertaineth unto a man, neither shall a man put on a woman's garment.
Put on, that means physical, right? So it's article of clothing that God has for men and women. To answer your question, sis, our sisters that wear pants was instituted by God to give to the Levites.
Right.
And then the Levites shared that out to the men of Israel.
Right.
So it's no history nowhere. Give me one queen that wear pants. Give me one. Royalty doesn't wear pants. Royalty doesn't cross-dress. God has a law between cross-dressing. But why is that okay in our community? Why is it that our women can wear pants and put on their masculine energy, but then you just said if a man put on the bra, the panties, and the skirts, he put on the female energy? Why? No, you know what the agenda is? You know what the agenda is? Sin.
Right.
I just told you what they know about us. Oh, yes, sir. They tricking you into sin. You didn't even know how to identify yourself. You didn't. What is your nationality? Again, for the fourth time. Okay, let's see. Before we go, look right here. This is your God-given name. See this? This is your westernized or bastardized name that they claim, they labeled you. God named these people Judah, Benjamin, Levi, Ephraim, Simeon. These are your God-given names. When you got relabeled, give me Deuteronomy 28. What is that? 37. Yes, sir. No, because y'all got to hear this. Y'all really got to hear this because what are you going to do? Smoke, drink, buy a little food, that's it? That's your life? That is your life? That sounds like a slave to me. It's like a slave, bro. I'm tired of being a slave. I'm going to just be real with you. I'm tired of being a slave. When are y'all going to be tired? When are you going to be tired of being a slave and want to be a king? When are you going to be tired, sister, for being a slave and put on your righteous apparel? Nah, you ain't tired enough. You're not tired enough. Read that. One more script. Read that.
Deuteronomy chapter 28, verse 37. And thou shalt become an astonishment, a proverb, and a byword among all nations, whether the Lord shall lead thee.
So everywhere we was led, we was called something out of our God-given name. That's a true prophecy. So with it being true, how do we turn back? We got to keep God's commandments again. We got to start learning who we are. If I were to ask you, okay, what is your nationality? What nation do you stem from? You should proudly say, I stem from the nation of Israel. Then you give your tribe. Then you say, I'm from the tribe of Judah. I'm from the tribe of Benjamin. I'm from the tribe of Levi. But if you can't say that, the enemy won, bro. You can't tell me that there's a lot of conspiracies going out here and you're a part of the conspiracy yourself.
Nation is men leading by example. Nation is family. Nation is community. Nation is children with role models.
Strong in the Lord, his word.